Joining me now is Daryl Johnson, a publicist for R. Kelly. I'm so glad to have you here. Thank you. The world is fascinated with this story, and we appreciate you joining us here this evening. So let's talk about today the mother of Jocelyn Savage said that she is pleading for a face-to-face interview with you to arrange it between her daughter.
Well,
you say that could happen as early as this week?
It could happen if all the terms are met.
So can you tell us what the conditions are? What are the conditions?
Based on the last meeting, I heard that happened. It turned out pretty bad.
Okay.
So I want something contained. We'd have maybe one camera, a mediator, not to just let them do what they do, and someone to sit and just listen. And when it's over, perhaps interview each participant there and say, you know, what did you get out of it? And then, you know, everybody got what they wanted.
I wanted to get that out of the way because that's the newest piece of information in this, is at the meeting, because there are two families here who have been saying that their daughters are being held hostage. You've reached out to one family. The other family, well, you've reached out to both. The other family you're trying to get in touch with to arrange a meeting as well.
I'll get in touch with them tomorrow.
Okay. He's facing 10 charges of aggravated criminal sexual abuse. It's after two decades, Daryl, of constant accusations. These women are lying?
I'm not calling anybody a lawyer. What I would say is, to those people who have brought the facts to attorneys, present your facts, and Mr. Kelly will have his day in court. Now, if I was a judge, me personally, and I thought a guy was a known pedophile over the last 30 years, why is probation even on the table? If this guy is a known pedophile, if he's holding these people hostage, why haven't the doors be kicked in?
Well, I mean, I think that's a legal process. I don't think that speaks to guilt or innocence.
I'm not saying that. I'm just saying if a judge over these years thought that this is what it was, you got enough to indict, just have zero bond.
Yeah. Well, speaking of that, he couldn't come up with $161,000 in child support, $100,000 in bail money, and the rest. Who came up with that money?
Let me say this first. Mr. Kelly walked into court with $60,000. Mm-hmm. It was about those children. That's what they said. He said, Judge, I have 60 grand. They said, nope, we want 161, 637, 18. That's what we want. Not a penny less. He went to jail, but it was about the kids. If it's about the kids, you can get those kids the $60,000 and then you work something out. Yeah. They didn't want that.
So who came up with the money?
Fans.
Fans.
Fans came up with the money.
So no one you know personally?
I don't know anybody.
He knows personally.
Yeah. Plausible deniability. I know nothing.
And does he know who it is?
I don't think he knows.
Okay. So after all these years, when you think it's a remix to Ignition, all of these songs, right, that he has, R. Kelly can't come up with that amount of money?
You know what?
Kelly's made millions.
Michael Jackson made billions. He died broke. Whitney Houston, from what I understand, Tyler Perry had to fly her body and pay for her funeral. This is what I understand. Now, this is what I heard. And so things happen. I mean, things happen. You know, R. Kelly he said, you know, he doesn't read that well. Mm-hmm. He said that, you know, he's not the best writer.
So he mismanaged his money. He spent it all.
I'm not going to say he spent it all. A lot of people took advantage of him, too.
Okay. So you set up this interview with Gayle King, and we all saw this moment right here. I want you to look at this.
Y'all killing me with this. I gave y'all 30 years of my
I hope this camera keep going.
No, we're gonna
this
let
is
the
not
camera
true.
Keep rolling.
Okay, this is not, doesn't even make sense. Why would I hold all these
So
women?
What do you think of that? Is R. Kelly in control of himself as this crisis person? What do you think of that moment in the interview?
If I was facing 7 years in the state penitentiary, I'm not gonna say I would act like that, but I mean, how do you act when you're gonna spend the rest of your life in prison? Mm-hmm. I thought it was a real moment.
You think that helped him?
Well, you know what? We'll see. At the end of the day, people are gonna judge whatever they think anyway. I think the interview needed to happen. I really do believe it. And I think there are several things that happened that followed after that. So I think it did help him. I don't think the emotions are going so high, but I think he was being himself.
I think most people are worried, like they think, gosh, what is going on? I'm just being honest. I'm not judging either way. But if I look at that, I'm going to say, man, R. Kelly. Whew. And if you're close to him, you got to be worried about him.
Well, I'm not worried. I'm a crisis management expert. That's what I do. And so my job is to help my client navigate from point A to point Z to help him understand what is happening. Again, we have to let the facts take us where we go. And right now, you know what, I'm not really I'm not really sure. I'm hearing a lot of stuff.
So can I ask you, the Illinois State's Attorney's Office says that there has video evidence of R. Kelly and an underage girl, and there are people who insist it's R. Kelly on the tape and the girl.
It's called discovery. If you have the tape, release the tape and bring it out. If it's the girl that you say it is, then why is he walking around? Why was there a bun? I wouldn't have given him a bun. I'm just a practical thinking person.
The families of all these women who say they're being held against their wills, R. Kelly has brainwashed them into staying with him. Why would he engage in a relationship like that? Does he have any responsibility, you believe?
Let me say this to you. I've been with Mr. Kelly for 3 weeks, 6 hours a day. I have a key swab. I can walk into his apartment when I get ready. I take his phone at will. I go through his phone. I'm with him. Half time, he's not even there. He's playing basketball or at the cigar lounge, things that he likes to do to calm his mind. Those young ladies come freely. I'm there.
So, Daryl, you said you've been with him for 3 weeks.
He's my client. He's my client. What I'm saying to you is,
this has been going on since the 90s. It's almost three decades.
I can't speak on what the 90s. I'm telling you right now what I'm dealing with.
The accusations.
The accusations is that these two young ladies in the home with him now are brainwashed, being held hostage, not being fed, in some black room, being told what to say. I've been there and have not seen that.
So everyone wants to know about the underage girls, right? And then he says, he said it wasn't underage girls, it was just he likes women, right? But Aaliyah was 15, or some folks say 14. He never addresses that. You don't address that.
I don't know Aaliyah. I wasn't around. I can't speak on something that I don't know nothing about. There's never been any criminal charges brought up him against Aaliyah. I've heard a whole lot of things about some other people.
Yeah, but you're representing him. Shouldn't you know about that?
Should I know about what?
About what happened with Aaliyah.
I'm not an attorney. My job is to deal with what's happening right now. I'm not going to call anybody like, but what I would say, my client has professed his innocence. That's what he's professed. He will have his day in court.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I really appreciate it. Mm-hmm. Daryl Johnson. Mm-hmm.